ओके, सो आई विल सी द एक्सेस मेथड्स दैट आर यूज टू एक्सेस अ पर्टिकुलर मेमोरी. ओके, सो वी हैव फर्स्ट टाइप ऑफ एक्सेस मेथड इज नोन एज द सिक्वेंशियल एक्सेस मेथड. सिक्वेंशियल एक्सेस मेथड लिमिट्स द एक्सेस मेथड. दैट मीन्स यू कैन एक्सेस अ पर्टिकुलर मेमोरी इन अ पर्टिकुलर सीक्वेंस ओनली. सो आई नो इफ यू हैव सीन द मैग्नेटिक टेप्स और द टेप रिकॉर्डर और टेप टेप बेस्ड म्यूजिक सिस्टम्स इन साइड योर हाउस. बट यस, दिस दोज आर द एग्जाम्पल्स ऑफ अ सिक्वेंशियल मैथड. इन दैट इफ यू वॉन्ट टू लिसन अ पर्टिकुलर सॉन्ग यू हैव टू गो थ्रू ऑल द प्रीवियस सॉन्ग्स. लाइक इन अ पर्टिकुलर ट्रैक, इफ यू वॉन्ट टू लिसन ट्रैक नंबर 7, सो यू हैव टू गो थ्रू फ्रॉम ट्रैक नंबर 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Then you are coming to the 7. So yes, to skip these things, we have a forward option which will quickly skip the tape. That means rotating the tape in a faster way. So leave that thing. We are discussing here about the sequential access method. So in sequential access method, we can access the data in a particular sequence. So that means the access time of a particular data will be dependent on the location of the data. That means the data that is stored at the end of the tape will require the time, or you can say it require an additional time. That means reading the all the previous locations. So sequential access methods are basically used in tapes. So we have storage tapes also that are also used nowadays, even nowadays in the data centers. And tape is an example of the music system. So you have, if you haven't seen, you can assume that we have a tape on which the data is written. So by rotating the tape, we are reaching to the different locations and we are saving the data. So this tape are basically magnetic storage. Now direct access method is used in our magnetic hard drives. So direct access method is normally you cannot put it into the sequential or you cannot put it into the random access. So this kind of access method, in this kind of access method, each individual block has a unique address. That's why it is known as a direct access method. That means every block is having a unique address, but for accessing that particular data, we have to jump first to the particular vicinity and then we need to do some sequential search. So you can see at this particular track, that means this particular track rotation will be a kind of sequential search, but rest of them is a kind of random search. So this is a kind of combination of random plus sequential search. Example is your hard drive that we are discussing. So we'll see the details of this hard disk in the later section. The access method that the hard drive uses is known as a direct access method because each individual block is having a unique address. Now, third one is your random access method. So, random access method is in which individual addresses identify the location exactly. That means you can reach the particular location with zero time. Zero time means every location is equally accessible. Equally accessible means all the location will require equal amount of time to access that particular location. Your RAM is one such example that is known as the random access memory, because it you can access any block inside the RAM with equal access time. Okay, now talking about the performance of a memory system. So access time is one of the measure of your performance of the memory system. So time between presenting the address and getting the valid data is known as the access time. That means if your CPU generates a particular address, okay, from that time till you receive the data is known as the access time. Second performance parameter is known as the memory cycle time. It is the time for the memory to be recovered before the next access. So in case of some memory, you require some time so that the next access can be started. Okay, transfer rate is one of the important criteria. That means how much amount of data we can transfer per unit time is known as the transfer rate, or you can say it's simply the speed at which you can read or write the data. So this is one of the important point of a performance for a memory system. So the the transfer rate is basically measured in kbps or mbps. So at this point you have to remember that whenever we are talking about the transfer rate or the same speed in the case of network speed, so when we are talking about k or m, we are talking about 10. That means we are talking about 1000. So if you're talking about the transfer rate, 1000 means 1 kilo means 1000, not 1024. When you are talking about the storage, 1024 means 1 kilo. But when you are talking about the transfer rate or network speed, it is 1000 only. So 1 kbps is 1 × 10⁻³ bits per second. 1 mbps is 1 × 10⁶ bits per second. Okay, then 1 kbps, if you're talking about the big B, then you have to multiply it with 8. So 1 kbps is 8 times kbps, and 1 mbps is 8 × 1 mbps. Okay, next is your physical type. That means the material by which we have created this particular memory. So for this we have options of semiconductor memory. So RAM is one example. Your flash drives are also semiconductor memory. That means your pen drive is also a semiconductor memory. If you talk about the magnetic, you have disk and tape. Disk is your hard disk, or you can say the secondary memory. Tape is your, you can search your Google to find out what a tape is if you are unaware of this. Now talking about the optical. So in the case of optical storage, we actually uses the laser beam. That's why it is known as the optical. CD is one example and DVD is one example. So it might be possible that if you haven't seen a CD, again you can go through the Google. So this comes under the category of optical storage. Other examples are bubble and hologram. So yes, they can store some value, some data. So they can also termed as one storage, or you can say even the barcode is can store some data. So that can also one type of storage. So we have to focus on the above three: semiconductor, magnetic and optical. Now coming up to the physical characteristics. So we have the physical characteristics of decay, volatility, erasability and power consumption. Decay means, suppose if you store a data in a particular location, okay, and you leave it. So what can be a decay? The data that is stored may lose the quality. Like you have seen, if you take out some old recordings, the quality is down because of the decay that is happening due to the environment condition, due to the temperature, due to the time. Yes, the decay is possible because the data is stored in form of, suppose, magnetic material. So the time, after some time, the polarization or the magnetic material quality will decay. So the decay is one of the property of the physical characteristics. The minimum is the decay, and the better is the storage. The longevity of the storage is maintained if the decay is less. Longevity. Next is your volatility. Volatility is nothing but the data is requires power supply to be retained or not. So RAM is volatile storage. Secondary storage is a non-volatile storage. Erasability. We'll study erasability in the idea of ROMs only. ROM only, because ROM is require this kind of concept. We'll see third point later. Talking about the power consumption. So there are some storage which requires power. There are some storage which even do not require power for read, write or storage. Okay, one more interesting point is coming up, that is known as the memory hierarchy. What is memory hierarchy? Memory hierarchy is a way to organize different types of memory in a computer system. This hierarchy is designed to decrease the access time of the system. That means we can have a faster access of the data. Second, to optimize the cost of the overall memory system with the required system performance. That means this is a design, or you can say our organization, designed with a purpose to decrease the access time, decrease the cost, okay, and achieve the required system performance. It also provides a larger memory capacity. So these are the three things on which we have created the, or system designer have created this memory hierarchy. The target is to decrease the access time, decrease the cost or optimize the cost, and provide the larger capacity. These three goals are there. So based on these three goals, we have devised this kind of arrangement. This is a pyramid, not a triangle. You can see or think it as a pyramid only. So if you put your eye at the top of the pyramid, or this kind of view is known as the bird eye view. So if you use the bird eye view of this particular memory hierarchy, you will get a fastest memory, okay, and the largest memory. That means if you are at the top of this hierarchy, you are having the CPU registers, okay, but whenever you need the data, it is available in the magnetic tape. So at this point, you are getting the fastest and the largest memory. So whenever the data is required, it can be transferred from magnetic tape to optical disk to magnetic disk, to the main memory, cache memory, and CPU register. So these are different levels of hierarchy, and we are normally work up to the level 3 only: CPU, cache, main memory, and magnetic disk. So why, how we are getting the fastest memory? Because we have CPU registers at the top. Why we are getting the largest memory? Because we can use the memory portion from the magnetic disk whenever it requires. That means whenever it requires, it can be transferred to the main memory. So this is why this particular memory hierarchy works. If you go from bottom to top, increase in the cost per bit. That means this is the cheapest memory and this is the costliest memory. When you come from top to bottom, the capacity will increase as well as the access time will be increased, because these are the slower memory as compared to the CPU register. So this is the memory hierarchy arrangement. The target of such organization is to achieve a larger memory and cheaper memory and faster memory. And this organization is fulfilling your particular desire. And this particular hierarchy is used in every system also. Like in your normal system, there is a register set, then cache memory, then main memory, then secondary memory. And then there is option of flash memory and optical disk also. Not only that, the cache memory is divided into different levels, like L1 cache, L2 cache, and L3 cache also. Okay. Talking about the first type of memory, that is known as the register. So registers are located inside the CPU. They are made from flip-flop. So we will see flip-flop in the later lectures. So for the time being, you just remember that registers are made up of flip-flop, and flip-flops are nothing but a digital circuit which can store one bit of data. That means it can store either 0 or 1. Talking about the size of the register. So size of the register is decided by the system architecture. That is, for n-bit processor, the size of the register is n. Like if you are talking about a 64-bit processor, register size is of 64. Numbers, so generally we are having like from 16 to 100 registers, okay. They are used to hold temporary data while a program is in execution. They are of two types. One is known as a general purpose, other is known as a special purpose. General purpose registers can be used for data storage or any other task, but special purpose registers are assigned some predefined task. Okay, so we will see these details when we are working on the control unit design and ALU design. Second is your cache memory. So cache memory is devised due to the high access time of main memory. Okay. So due to the high access time of main memory, a faster memory is placed between the CPU and the main memory, which is known as the cache memory. And not only that, it is a faster memory, but for cache memory, we are exploiting the data property Or you can say that the data access property that is known as the locality of reference. Along with that, we are using different algorithms to achieve the overall system performance. Now, talking about the locality of reference, reference is somewhere referring to the property of the access. That suppose if you are accessing a particular data, then what is the probability of accessing the data near about, like if you are accessing a location X, then what is the probability of accessing X plus 1? And second property is like, suppose you are accessing a particular memory block X, then what is the probability of accessing it again? So these two are known as the spatial locality and temporal locality. We will see these in detail in lecture unit 5. So locality of reference comes in two parts, spatial locality and temporal locality. So for designing the cache memory, we exploit these two properties and we use different algorithms to achieve the overall performance. The cache memory in nowadays is comes into the three level of cache, L1, L2 and L3 cache. Okay. Next is your RAM or primary memory or random access memory. So we will see detail about the RAM. It is a volatile memory. Volatile memory means it loses the content whenever the power gone. That means whenever you turn off your computer, the data that is stored inside the RAM will be gone. It is random access, that is any cell of the memory can be accessed with same amount of time. Like out of these 64,000, approximately 64,000 memory locations, you can access any memory location with the same amount of time. Now the RAM size is limited by the size of the address bus. Remember this thing, the size of the RAM is limited by the size of address bus. That means RAM size is equals to 2 raised to the power n, where n is the number of bits of the address bus. So agar we are talking about address bus size of 32 bits, that means 2 raised to the power 32 is equals to 4 GB. So we cannot have a RAM greater than 4 GB. We can attach a lesser size of memory, no issues, but we cannot attach a higher memory than 4 GB. So yes, the RAM size will be limited by the size of the address bus. For example, if you are having a 64 KB of RAM, so the address string length will be, now talking about the address string length, so address string length will be log base to 64K, so which comes out to be 16 bits. So this is one example, this is our example of 64 KB, so in which we are using this RAM size of 64 KB. So the address length will be 16 bit, but what we have represented, we have represented them into the hex or hexadecimal. So hexadecimal compresses the 16 bit into 4 bit data. So the address range is represented in this form, 0000 to FFFF. This is how the main memory addresses are represented. They are generally represented into hex format. So this is why a 16 bit string is converted into 4 bits string. Now how do the CPU accesses the RAM? This we have to see, that how the RAM will be accessed by the CPU. So this diagram is showing very simplest possible RAM of size 8 bit. Okay, so this particular RAM will be accessed by the CPU. Fine. So first we have to find out the address length. So we have total 8 blocks. So finding out the address length is simple. We just take the log base 2 of 8, that is coming out to be 3. That means the address length will be 3. It is very simple, because if you are using 3 bits, we can generate 8 different combinations. So there are 8 cells, so we can address each cell individually and uniquely. So that's why the address length is 3. Okay. Now this particular memory is byte addressable. Byte addressable means each cell size is of 8 bit. Now talking about the data bus size. So data bus size will be word size, that is 8 bit. Okay. And we are having one control line for read write using the data bus. Okay. So we have collected all the data that is required. So let's see in this particular diagram. This is your address bus. The size of address bus is 3 bits. So this cross marker represents the size. Whenever we have a thick line, this means that we are using multi-bit bus. So in the multi-bit bus, whenever there is a cross and the number is representing the size of that particular bus. So this address bus is of size 3 bits. This data bus size is of 8 bit, which we have calculated over here. So this is your address bus size, and this is bidirectional because data can move to and fro. Address cannot move to and fro, that is why it's a unidirectional arrow. And there is one control line which represents that whether we have to read the data or we have to write the particular data. So in this particular example, your CPU wants to read the memory location 100. So what it does, it will generate an address 110, and this 110 will be assigned to this address bus. So when 110 will be assigned to this address bus, it will pick one memory location 110, and this 110 will represent by 1001, or having the data 1001 1001. Fine. So this RAM, or you can say this particular block, will be accessed by this data bus. And we have a signal of read. So this particular data 1001 1001 will be copied to this data bus, and via this data bus it will be transferred to the CPU. So this is one example that how the data is read from the main memory to the CPU. Now if you want to write some data, you have to set the address bus accordingly. Okay, then you have to load that data into the data bus, and on this control bus you can send the write signal. So the same data will be written on that particular memory cell. Okay, next is your ROM. So ROM is nothing but read only memory. It can be written only once and read many times. It is generally made for storing permanent data such as firmware and device information. This we have already discussed. M cross N ROM is an array of M words on N bit size. This is fine. This is same as the RAM. But we don't have any kind of read write signals, and we are having one address bus, and by default the operation is read only. So we have seen about the control unit, that control unit uses the micro operations or micro program. So whenever we want to store this micro program, ROM can be used, because for a particular processor, these micro operations is unique and one time stored. So this is why we can use ROM for this micro program of the control unit. Okay, next is your types of ROM. So since ROM is a permanent storage, it uses fuses. Fuses means, suppose if you are aware with the Zener diode, so Zener diode is having some threshold voltage. When that particular threshold voltage crosses, it fuses. So the ROM generally uses this property of Zener diode. So whenever you are talking about the fuses in this particular, you can assume a Zener diode only. Okay, so whenever we want to write zero, what we do, we supply a voltage higher than the threshold voltage, so the diode gets fused. Okay, and whenever we want to represent a particular diode as one, we just do not fuse it. Fine. So in this way we can create an arrangement of bits like 0 1 0 1 1 1 0, something like this. So the fuses arranged arranged in such a way that selectively we particularly fuse a particular fuse, or you can say burn a particular fuse. The correct word is burn a particular fuse. Now if you're talking about the types of ROM, so these writing methods is used to categorize the ROM. So the first ROM, or you can say the ROM that is mask programmable, is known as the ROM only. So it is one time designable and it is generated by the manufacturer only. That means you provide that this data you want to store into the ROM, and the manufacturer will produce that particular ROM only by fusing the selectively Zener diodes. Second type is known as the PROM, or you can say the programmable ROM, and it can be burned using a special hardware, and that hardware can be used inside a lab. So this kind of ROM is programmable ROM, like you can program it inside your premises, not in the house, because this will require some cost and environment, but yes, a specialized lab can have the PROMs. Now, ROM and PROM both are irreversible. Irreversible means that if you have written the data, you cannot change it. But yes, there may be some requirement whenever you want to upgrade your firmware, or whenever you want to change your firmware, then you need to have a rewritable ROM. It's not easily rewritable like RAM, but yes, there is a possibility, or you can say a cost saving, or you can say a environment friendly way. So we have a erasable ROMs available. So first category is known as EPROM. These are erasable PROMs, and the data of these erasable PROMs can be erased with the exposure of the UV light. Next category is EEPROM. So EEPROM are electrically erasable PROMs, which can be erased with the help of electric signals. So as compared to EPROM and EEPROM, do not uses the UV light, but it uses the electric signal to erase the particular data on the ROM. Okay, next is your secondary storage. So secondary storage is your hard drive. So we'll see in detail what are the secondary storage available and how they function, and along with the virtual memory. Okay, talking about the secondary memory, so generally secondary storage comes in the magnetic disk form. Magnetic disk form means they are using the magnetic based storage for generating the storage devices. Now these magnetic storage does what? They uses the polarity to differentiate between 0 and 1. So suppose we assume that north polarization of the magnetic material will be treated as 1, and south polarization will be treated as 0. Something like this. This kind of convention can be used to represent 1 and 0. So what is storage? Storage is nothing but the representation of 0 and 1. If you have a representation of 0 and 1, we can create any kind of storage. Okay, so in magnetic, we are using the polarization to generate the representation for 0 and 1. Apart from magnetic storage, we have an option of solid state storage. Solid state storage is nothing but your pen drive with a larger capacity. The magnetic storage uses the polarization direction as 0 and 1, as I have already discussed. The magnetic disk is a collection of circular platter with arranged on the central spindle with read-write head. So we will see this design of the secondary storage in the next PPT. Next slide. Okay. This particular diagram is taken from the operating system book written by Galvin. So this is a particular example of a magnetic disk. So yes, it is a collection of platters. So suppose in this particular diagram we can see 3, there may be 4 or 5, something, not more than 5 is sufficient. Now you can see per platter we have 2 read-write heads. So on above and below surface we are having the magnetic material. So above and below both are having the magnetic material, so we can read or write the data on both the particular platter. We have set of such platters, so for every platter we have 2 such read-write heads. Okay, now each platter is divided into tracks. Tracks are nothing but the circular sections, and each track is divided into sectors. So data is read or written in the form of sectors only. Now talking about the read-write head. So read-write head is nothing but a simple coil small size coil. That coil is used to induce, is used to read and write the data, and how it is reading or writing the data, it generates a certain amount of current, certain with a certain direction, that will create a particular type of polarization. Okay, so suppose if you take clockwise, if the current is flowing in the coil as clockwise, it will generate some kind of polarization, and it is, if it's flowing in the anti-clockwise direction, it will generate some other type of polarization, like one is north and other is south. So north is representing one and south is representing zero. So for storing this data, the coil or read-write heads generate the current in the particular way, in the particular direction, if you want to read a particular, if you want to write a particular data. Now for the reading purpose, it does not generate any current, it just kept above the surface, and based on the magnetic polarity direction, the current is generated on the particular read-write head, and the read-write head will read the, notice the direction of the current, and based on the direction of the current, one or zero will be differentiated. Okay, you can get more detail about this from any YouTube lecture, and that will be shared along with this video lecture. So you can go in depth detail. This is a basic overview of how this magnetic disk works. Now next is your solid state drives. Now solid state drives are gaining momentum because of it does not have any moving part. Now when we are having a non-moving part, that means these particular solid state drives are more reliable, and they also provide the faster access. Normally you have seen like the hard drive crashes due to the physical shock, or suppose your external magnetic disk falls from some surface, or it just so the data might, the hard drive might get crashed because it is having those moving parts. But as compared to that, SSD do not have any kind of moving part, so it is more stable kind of storage. So as per the Wikipedia, solid state drive, also known as the SSD, it's a solid state storage device that uses IC, integrated circuit assemblies, to store data persistently, typically uses flash memory, and functioning as a secondary storage in the hierarchy of the computer storage. So they are nothing but, I have already told you, a large size flash memory. Large size flash memory, or you can say a large size of flash or pen drive. Basic example of large size of pen drive. Now it uses NAND flash drive, flash memory. It does not use DRAM. So when you can see that DRAM is also used in the cache memory, DRAM is not used. It uses the NAND based flash memory, which is more reliable. Next is your virtual memory. So I have already discussed what virtual memory is. Virtual memory is nothing but a kind of virtual storage that is created with the help of secondary storage. That means some part of RAM has been extended with the help of secondary storage. So there are a lot of benefits of this virtual memory. That means we can have a larger logical storage as compared to your RAM. Second thing, virtual memory does one thing, that only the part of the program that is required to be into the memory will be put into the execution. Like suppose your program is of 1000 MB, and at a time you are using only 200 MB. So only 200 MB will be loaded. Example is like in your gaming, there are multiple stages. So if you are using virtual memory, so a particular stage data will be loaded into the RAM because you are playing at the particular stage, not the whole data will be loaded. Fine. So this basically creates, provides some efficiency, a larger storage and other things. You will see, you will get a detailed discussion on virtual memory in the operating system lectures. There are two ways we can implement the virtual memory. One is known as the demand paging, other is known as the demand segmentation. This is the diagram how this virtual memory works. So this is your logical space. In this logical space, you can simply see that this is larger than your physical memory. The reason is that there are swap in swap out process going on from this physical memory. Like your program is stored into the secondary storage, and whenever a particular block is required, it will be picked up from the secondary storage and it is utilized. And when some block is not useful, then it will put back again to the secondary memory. So this is how the virtual memory works. So this concludes our discussion of the memory.